coming back to your heart. Now I surrender, take me. This is all I can bring.
Song. Welcome to Chapel Hill this morning. What a good looking crowd, and I can actually recognize most of you. We are no longer required to wear the mask. You are allowed to if you feel more comfortable, and if you do not have one, we'd be happy to supply one. Since we're honoring veterans today, if you are a veteran of any of our armed forces, would you please rise so we can thank you. I myself am a veteran of a couple of wars, but not in the armed forces. November the 9th, which is coming up quickly, we'll be sponsoring a blood drive with the American Red Cross as part of the emergency appeal. With the COVID situation, a lot of people have not given blood and supplies are running very, very low. So if you can, please make arrangements to be here from 12 to 5 p.m. on the 9th. And Miss Carol Odom was all set to make a couple of announcements, and she's got a sore throat. So she gave me a script. As you heard last week, we had a successful trunk or treat. Our Children's Family Ministries team would like to thank Robin Trimble, who helped contact people. We had 20 trunks, and we want to thank all of you who came and endured that cold and windy day. And we want to thank everyone who donated candy. We completely ran out and had to buy more. We also had the prayer wall set up, and we received 44 prayer requests, praise the Lord, many written by children. We prayed over these prayer requests last Monday in our staff meeting, and Pastor Mike has those prayers today. And her second announcement is about the angel tree. Christmas is coming, as you've probably witnessed from all the decorations at Walmart and Lowe's. An angel tree, I swear to you, is one of the greatest gifts you can give this time of year. As you may have already seen, we have angel tags from the Salvation Army Angel Tree Program. This year we have 75 name tags. If you're not familiar with the Angel Tree Program, it is a program the Salvation Army uses to get donations for specific families who sign up in the Henderson County area. Each tag contains all the information you will need to purchase gifts for that child. It contains their clothing sizes, specific needs, and wants for this Christmas. All gifts must be new. There's a list on the table in the narthex next to the angel tree, and once you have selected an angel, please find that child's name and number on the list and provide your own name and telephone number. We have copies of each of these angels, so if something happens to your angel or you lose it, let us know and we'll get you the information again. The deadline for returning gifts to the Salvation Army is Friday, December 10th. As in previous years, we ask that you return your gifts to the church on or before the prior Sunday, December 5th, and we'll take them to the Salvation Army. If you prefer to take your gifts directly to the Salvation Army, please contact the church office so that they know your gift has been returned. Now we're going to, again, to honor the veterans, and we thank you so much. We have a little clip we want you to watch.
The 11th hour does not strike on the clock of every man. For at this time, most of us can be found at home, comfortable, knowing tomorrow is right on its way. At the 11th hour, most of us can be found in our beds. But in another world, our men and our women, our brothers and our sisters live in this hour. Tick, 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 tick. Every second for you. Every second for me. So it was on the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month of 1918. The guns were lowered. The trenches grew silent. And an armistice was declared between the Allied nations and Germany. A great war hushed so that the wives, the children, the fathers and the mothers could salute back across the ocean. And it is on this day each year that we have stopped to salute our veterans, our men and women of the 11th hour. So today, it's our turn. It's our turn to show our gratitude. It's our turn to applaud when they stand. It's our turn to thank God for you. Yes, it's our turn to say thank you for going in our stead.
Servicemen have done. Often we take it for granted. I know I have. until I had a son who enlisted. That changed everything for me. Made me look at it a lot different. And so if you see someone out that you know that's in the service, tell them thank you. And buy their lunch. Do something. Let them know that you care and you appreciate them. But we really want to get together here this morning and let our God know that we appreciate Him. So let us stand as we worship today. I'm loving seeing all your faces. Now, for me, I should have put a mask on, but you all are looking good. And it's a great day, really a great day. So we have much to be thankful for. So let's thank Him today through our worship. Amen.
Henderson State, he was here white as snow.
Loose the fateful lightning of his terrible sweet soul. Thank you for that. We want to go to a time of prayer now. Before we do that, I wanted to announce November the 21st. Mark that on your calendars. We're going to do things a little bit differently on November 21st. We're just going to have one service. It'll be at 10 o'clock. So mark that on your calendars, 10 o'clock. Get that on your agenda. So November the 21st. 10 o'clock service. And the reason we're doing that is we want to celebrate Keith Vincent's. He's going to be retiring. He's actually retiring at the end of, I think he's got 4 weeks off that the church has given him, and then he's going to come back and on the 21st, and we're going to celebrate that retirement. So we want to get, I hope you come, and I hope you use that opportunity. There's going to be a service, and then afterwards a little bit of I think something to fellowship and eat and that kind of thing. Use that opportunity just to kind of come up to him and say thank you to him for his, how many years? 20-some years, 22 years of service here at the church. And so just use that as an opportunity to maybe give him a note or say a thank you to him. But we're going to be celebrating that on the 21st. So just mark that in your calendars. Another thing I wanted to say is that we did have the trunk or treat, and We had a lot of prayer requests. I'm holding those prayer requests plus last week's prayer requests in my hand. One of the things that struck me as we were praying for these things as a staff is a lot of times a child would fill it out. And there was a couple of them where there were just pictures drawn or something like that. It just kind of made you, a little laugh. We laughed a little bit about it before we started praying. But then we started in on the prayer, and we started naming the things that these little children were saying that they wanted prayer for. And I can't go through them for you, but they were really tugging at our hearts, and our staff ended up just weeping before the end of the prayer, because we realized that we literally were standing in the gap for people who didn't know really how to pray necessarily, but they were writing these things that they wanted down for God. And so we stood in that gap. And that's what we do every Sunday morning when I say this pastoral prayer. I say we pray for those outside the walls of this church. I hope you're not just hearing that and saying, oh, that's kind of interesting or something like that. I hope you lean into that, and that you lift up your prayer during that time for the hearts and lives in our community, because there are those who don't know how to approach God. They don't know the proper way to do it, and there is a proper way. Amen. There's a way that we come to God through Jesus, and that makes our prayers effective. And so as we do that as a church, we are standing in the gap for those who do not yet know how to pray. So with that being said, we're going to pray over these things. But if you have a prayer request on your heart, if you have someone you've been praying for, lift your hand up. We'll pray for you this morning. All right, let's bow our heads together. Father, we thank you for your love for us, and we thank you in the name of Jesus, your Son, that you have come and that you have given us your life and have redeemed our lives. We hold this heavy weight of prayer requests before you, and every one of them, intimate desires of people in our community who want to receive something from you, who don't know exactly what they want to receive from you, who don't know exactly what's the best thing to receive from you, but we lift them up to you, every one of them, and we pray as your sons and daughters, we pray that these people will see in answered prayer your love for them, and that somehow they will see that miracle, and that it will mark their lives, and it will mark them with a shift that they turn toward you. We're praying, Father, for people to come into your kingdom, to come into your family, to get to know you, to understand what it means to be born again and to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. And we do lift these up to you, Father. We pray for those just a moment ago who lifted a hand indicating there are needs among us that we ask, God, that you would take care of, that you would minister to us. We reach out to you as children to a father, and we believe that you'll respond to us. And finally, Father, we do pray for our veterans, those who have suffered and who have endured the pain that should be ours. They have endured it for us. We want to thank you for them and pray their blessing today, blessing for them. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Now is that privileged time of the service when we get to return to God a portion of what He has blessed us with. I've been told to tell you this morning. Maybe you don't really need that one more pair of shoes, because there are those who are shoeless. Maybe you don't need another pair of pants, because there are men that have worn the same pair of pants for weeks. Maybe we don't need to take that little trip. My grandfather gave me the secret to joy. when he told me. I was about 12 years old. And he said, man can only live so good, all the rest is just showing off. That's not scriptural, but I've never found anything to be more true than that. So think about that and share what you have with those who are less fortunate. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for today. We thank you for the blessings that you heap upon us. We pray, Lord, for your mercy and your grace as we share what we have with those for various reasons don't have nearly as much as we do. We ask, Lord, that you multiply our gifts to fulfill the needs of this city and this county. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Very lovely. Thank you so much. Today's scripture reading comes from the book of Luke, chapter 22, verses 14 through 20. When the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table, and he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds fulfillment in the kingdom of God. After taking the cup, he gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among you, for I tell you I will not drink again from the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, this is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. The word of God for the people of God.
Amen. Let's bow our heads and pray over the words that Steve read for us. Father, we just thank you so much for your word. We thank you that as we come to it, every time we read, we know something is given to us, some word, some fresh truth. And as you breathe your life into these words of yours here today, I pray that every one of us would gain something from being here together and from looking into your word, leaning into your word. We pray for these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, amen. So as you can tell from the setup, by the way, that was a wonderful tune there. I was sitting behind him. I almost wanted to start humming. But that was like, you know, I can imagine they were like saying, get this guy behind us out of here. It's like, thank you there very much for that. Let's give him a hand at the end for that. That was wonderful. Beautiful. That was beautiful. So we're going to have communion in just a few moments, and I hope that stirs something in your heart when I say that. I hope you have a kind of a Christmassy, can't wait to get something kind of feeling when I talk about communion, because that's really what it is. And I think I talked a couple of weeks about this being probably the pinnacle of what Wesley would call means of grace. This is where it all centers for us. And if you don't get anything out of communion, I'm not sure what I can do for you, because that is where Jesus says the most impressive, most effective, most invasive form of God's fellowship with us comes to the table. So we're going to be doing that. And we're going to try to do it just like Jesus did it. Amen? We're not going to do any nuances, no different things. We're going to try to do it exactly the way Jesus and his disciples did it. Because when Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, he laid out a pattern for us to follow. And the church has been following this pattern for communion for centuries, literally thousands of years. And we have tried to do it like he has done it. He had bread and wine, and so we have bread and kind of wine, amen? So kind of wine, right? So it's grape juice. I'll give you the secret right now. So he gave thanks and blessed the elements, and so we give thanks and bless the elements. He set everything on a table, and so we set everything on a table, right? The Bible tells us that when the supper was ready, Jesus and his disciples reclined at a table. So that's part of our service. Now, we're not sure what the table they were sitting around looked like. We don't have a picture of it. We don't know how big it was. We don't know if it extended out with leaves, or if it had rounded edges, or if it had four legs or six or eight legs, or we don't know what this table looked like. I know we have that famous Da Vinci picture of the Lord's Supper where he's got this picture of it, but that wasn't a photograph, right? It was some artist's conception of what it looked like. So we're not sure what that first communion table looked like, but we do know this about the communion table, generically speaking. The communion table is a very long table. It's a very long table. When I got here this morning, I took this measuring tape and I went to our table and I measured how long it is. And just for your information, you may be curious about this, but our communion table is 54 and a quarter inches long. 54 and a quarter inches long. That's pretty long for a table. I don't think they go that long usually, but that's a long communion table, right? But if we could close our eyes, and if God could open our spiritual eyes and show us the communion table, we would realize that the communion table is much longer than 54 and a quarter inches long. I can remember, as a way of illustrating this, I can remember a couple of churches ago, the church I was pastoring decided to have a fellowship meal with some of the people, and they kind of set an open invitation, y'all come, kind of a thing. And when we got to the restaurant, we weren't sure how many people were going to show up for the meal, so we just ended up just pushing two tables together and seeing what would happen. But as more people came, we had to get another table and push it together. And then more people came and we pushed another table together. And it just kept growing and growing until we had, at the end of the day, we had a very long table. It was very irritating to the people at the restaurant that we had this long, long table for this group of people. Now, I tell you that story because that's a good picture of communion, I really believe. The word communion is very obviously a compound word. It's very simple. It's made up of two parts. The first word, come, and the second word, union. And that's a picture of communion. It's an invitation to everybody. It's just say, come, and let us be connected with each other. That's kind of why we call it communion. And if the table isn't long enough to seat everybody, then we just start pushing communion tables together, right? That's just what we're going to do. If not everybody can sit at the table, we're going to make sure that the table is long enough for everybody to sit. We have been pushing communion tables together for 2,000 years. It seats Baptists and Lutherans, Methodists and Presbyterians, Catholics and non-denominationals. It seats every little church that hangs out a sign. It's a long table. And it breaks out the wall, breaks out of the walls of this church, and it runs all through Henderson County. It extends out to Owensboro and down to Hopkinsville. It reaches Louisville and Lexington and all of eastern Kentucky. It passes state lines and national borders. It crosses oceans and international timelines. Anywhere two or three are gathered in his name to break the bread and take the cup. It's a long table. Amen? And it's not only a long table, it's an old table. Generically speaking, the communion table is a long table. It doesn't just extend out, it extends back. It seats people from all over the world and from every part of history. And it's just not a party of 5 or 10 or 15. It's literally a party of billions and billions of people. We're not eating alone here this morning. This is not something that we just do within the walls of this church. We eat together, right? And the first ones at the table were Jesus and his disciples. That was 2,000 years ago. And it's part of our corporate memory. We remember that event, the Gospels, word that story out for us. And it's something that we as the church will never forget. When Jesus instituted his meal and he served his disciples, he used some very specific wording. He said, do this in what? Remembrance of me, or memory of me. And the Greek word for that remembrance is the word anamnesis. Anamnesis. Okay, it's connected to the word amnesia, but it's got an ana in front of it, right? So amnesia is the loss of memory. How many of you have ever had amnesia before? I've got little bits and pieces of it, right? So amnesia is the loss of memory. Anamnesis is saying don't not remember, right? Jesus, in saying this to us, he's saying there's a tendency for all of us to get amnesia for little things, right? And there's things that you don't want to forget. It's dangerous to forget some things, right? If you forget to pay your insurance, that's a dangerous thing, right? Can you imagine your insurance lapsing and what would happen, life insurance or house insurance, that kind of thing? You can forget to do your license tags on your car, and that's a dangerous thing, right? There would be some impact on that. You can forget your anniversary. Don't want to do that? That's a terrible thing to do. So there's consequences for amnesia. So Jesus, in this specific case, he's saying, don't forget. Now, going back to the Old Testament, God was always telling his people, warning them not to forget. He knew that his time frame with his people would go thousands of years. And between stories of what God did, there would sometimes be a gap of 1,000 years, right? It was the Exodus or the creation or those kind of, and there's long gaps. And during those years and years and years, God says, don't forget. It's been 2,000 years since Jesus came. Don't forget, right? So God was always saying that. Right after he gave the commandments to Moses, Moses goes to the people and he says, these commandments I give to you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them to your foreheads. Write on your door frames and on your houses and on your gates. He's basically that little verse of scripture. If you go through it piece by piece, God wants his law or his religion to infiltrate every aspect of Israelite life. When God does something, he says, I'm going to do something, but I don't want you to just to celebrate it on Sunday morning and have the rest of the 6 days for yourself. I want what I'm doing to infiltrate the rest of your lives. And that's kind of what he's saying. He wants them to remember, not to forget. So the Israelites, they built altars, they stacked stones, they held festivals, they memorized Torah, all so that they would not forget. That was all designed so that Israelites would not forget. Sabbath was a reminder of God's creation, right? The sixth day God rested, and it was a reminder, a constant reminder. Every time you rest, it's a reminder of creation. God created you. You didn't just come out of nowhere. God made you, right? Passover was a reminder of God's deliverance of the Israelites from slavery. It was a reminder constantly, every year after year after year after year. I want you to remember something. You're free because of what I did for you, right? The Feast of Tabernacles was a constant reminder of the 40 years that they wandered in the wilderness. So God wanted them to remember that. The Feast of the First Fruits was a reminder that the harvest always comes from God. You give your first fruits to God because it's a representation of the fact that we know and acknowledge that everything that we do, all our abilities, all our productions, all the things that we produce, comes from God. And we're just saying, God, here's a little bit back, to say to you, we know you did this, right? And before Jesus ascended into heaven, he gave his disciples and us, by extension, he gave us a memento. How many of you ever had a memento? You know what a memento is? A memento is a physical, concrete reminder of some person or something, right? A memento, right? And so, for example, I've got this pocket knife. I brought this to the pulpit with me. If I were to show you this pocket knife, you'd look at it and say, oh, that's interesting. It looks like a pocket knife to you. But let me tell you what I see when I see this. This pocket knife was given to me by the widow of one of my former employers. His name was Laurel Maddox. He died several years ago. He was he's one of my first bosses. I worked for him as an electrician for 10 years, and Laurel and I wired houses together. Now, Laurel was a short man. He was about that tall, and he was about that wide, right? So about like that. And he was bald. And so he was, I will always have this impression of this wonderful man that I have fallen in love with, and I will see one day again when I get to heaven. But I remember stories about Laurel, my boss. One day we were going to wire this house, and we were packing in all of the stuff that we needed to wire the house, right? We were going in the sidewalk, and my boss, Laurel, was in front of me, and I was walking behind him. I had a box of stuff. He had a box of stuff. And I saw over him, because remember how tall he is, right? I saw over him this dog coming from the house. This medium-sized dog, vicious, teeth, real, just nasty-looking dog, coming to do us harm. There was no doubt what this dog's intentions were. He was making a beeline right for my boss, Laurel, because he was the first one in line, and he was going to rip Laurel apart, right? And so I can remember thinking, I'm holding this box, and Laurel's holding a box. I'm thinking, what's he going to do? I had no idea. He's just going to get ripped to shreds, and I'm just going to sit here and watch him. And to my surprise, Laurel took his leg and he kicked. And Laurel's not a young man, right? He wasn't a young man. But he kicked the daylights out of that dog's jaw, and that dog just turned right back around and went in the house. He was my hero. I couldn't believe it, but I'll never forget that story, right? And then another time, we're packing stuff into that another house. Is a different time, and I had this bundle of conduit. Right, conduit comes in 10-foot lengths, and it's a half inch around. And there's 10 of them in a bundle, so I'm carrying this bundle of conduit right into the house, and I didn't realize that Laurel was right behind me, right? And remember how tall Laurel is, right? So he's right underneath the bundle of conduit. So I go to put the bundle of conduit down, I went like this to put it down, and boom, right on his head, you know, and just like, just, I can remember that. It was a real fun time. And then there was another time that I was wiring something on top of a electric pole to a house. And I was doing the old split bolts. I don't know how many electricians remember the old split bolts. They were horrible things. And so I'm wiring up there. And Laurel Maddox was at the bottom. I was on a ladder. Laurel was below my ladder working on the, meter base. So he's working on the meter base. And I drop one of my pairs, my heavy pairs of Klein pliers. And they're heavy. Boy, they are not light things. They're heavy lineman kind of pliers. And I drop it. And it goes right straight down 20 feet to Laurel standing there. And it barely, I mean, if it hit him, it would have done, I don't know, who knows what would have happened. But it landed, just grazed his shoulder. Right, and just this pair of pliers, boom, you know. And I was looking down, and I didn't even have time to say, ew, or anything. But Laurel didn't even look up, right? Didn't he just, he was working, and the pliers land. He just went, he literally just went like this, and he said, Jiminy Kraut. Jiminy Kraut, I'd never forget it, Jiminy Kraut. So all these stories about Laurel, and I could just go on and on and on. And I see it all when I look at this pocket knife. Amen? Have you got something like that in your life that triggers things for us? They're called mementos, right? And so I wrote this poem. It's about memories. It goes like this. My heart is full of memories sent from a distant past. They tell me of my younger days. They've come and gone too fast. They call to mind long lost friendships and resurrect the dead. They echo distant whisperings, recalling what was said. They put me in a smaller frame and smooth my wrinkled skin. They conjure backdrops dear to me from somewhere deep within. They set me down on old floorboards in front of flowered walls. They walk with me as friendly ghosts down long and half-lit halls. My days with you are color-filled as we walk in the light, but days spent with my memories are all in black and white. Memories are powerful things, and I don't know if you're like me. Sometimes I just get paralyzed by this pause that happens when I think back of things that have happened in my life. Some good memories, some not so good. So Jesus gives bread and wine as a memento, right? So that every time we taste bread or wine, it brings us back to Him. It reminds us of Him. If I had to put a number on it, and this is important, if I had to put a number on it, I'd say that if you ask 10 church people how to get to heaven, how are you going to get to heaven? 9 out of 10 of them would probably say something like this. I feel like I'm doing pretty good. I'm a pretty good person. I do more good than I do bad. Let me just tell you something. If that's where you're at, please, it reflects poorly on me, right? Please, if you die and you get to heaven and God says to you, why should I let you into heaven? Please don't say, I'm good enough. That ain't happening. You ever, holiness, heaven is a holy place. The only thing that saves our souls, brothers and sisters, the only thing that gets us into heaven is that Jesus bled and died his perfect life for your imperfect life. That's the most important thing I'll ever say to you. And so that when you get to heaven, you don't say, I'm good enough. You say, he was good enough. And what he did was for me. And that's why these reminders are so important. It's so easy to forget. So many church people do forget. And they go sermon after sermon after sermon after sermon at the end of their lives. They completely forget the real issue. And that is, he paid it all. Let's bow our heads together. Father, as we come to this table, we give you thanks and praise. We recognize that if there is anything holy about us, if there is anything worthy about us, it comes from you and your Son and what he's given to us. And so we cast ourselves fully on the truth, the foundational and fundamental truth, that Jesus gave his life for us, and we are saved not by our good works, but by what Jesus did for us when he died on the cross for our sins. And so we come to this meal, Father, and ask you to give it a special blessing here today as a token, as a memento of that, so that we would remember in the deepest parts of our spirits that we have been given life by grace. And so we ask your grace on these elements. Make them to be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world around us the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You have your elements with you. If you would open the bread portion of it. I find that if I open them both, I spill all over the place. So just do the bread side. Let's all take the bread in our hands if we can. As we do this, on the night he had given himself for us, he took bread and he said, "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters, let's take this bread together. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup and he said, "This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Whenever you take this, do this in remembrance of me." Let's take together. We'll be right back.
glory from the impossible. We'll see a miracle. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. Move the immovable. Break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From the impossible. We'll see a miracle. God, we believe. God, we believe for it.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. Let's bow our heads together. Father, as we go from this place, we know that you go with us, the one who can move the immovable and break the unbreakable. And we do believe you for miracles. As we go, come with us, and we will spread your word for those who desperately need to hear. In Jesus' name, amen.
Miracle, God, we believe for.